Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, both in the room and, of course, online. I welcome you to this very important event and certainly a very innovative event. My name is Peter Olson, and I'll be your moderator today. And I don't know about any of you, but I've been hiding in my basement for the past 2 years and finally came out into the light to breathe the fresh air. And I must say, we still have to be careful, of course. We're wearing masks in the room. So let's get started here. Oh, by the way, the one thing I want to say, I'm also a cancer survivor. I was diagnosed about 10 years ago. And I had prostate cancer. I had surgery. And the little devils decided to wake up. So I went through a recurrence last year. And so I know what the journey to a degree is all about. And for those of you who are also taking this journey, at times it seems very lonely, but there is much support, and there is even more support with this new initiative. I'd like each of the panelists, if you could please tell us a little bit about yourself. And we'll start with Leslie.
Thank you, Peter. Hello and welcome. I'd like to first say thank you to all of the panelists for appearing today and also to Inspire Health and Royal Inland Hospital Foundation for coming together to put this initiative together for Kamloops and area residents. My name is Leslie Brochu, and I'm the chair of the Kamloops Cancer Supportive Care Society. I'm a business person. And most importantly, I'm the mother of a stage 4 metastatic melanoma cancer survivor. My son, who deteriorated to 4 weeks to end of life, and he was treated in a clinical study testing experimental treatment. As you know, this rocked my world in many ways that I could not even have imagined. But today, he is 5.5 years post-treatment. This experimental treatment he was on is now the standard of care. He's healthy, happy, handsome, a trailblazer for cancer survivor. And my motivation is to help others with this devastating experience. So I'm not auctioning him off, but he is here today with us. Although I would like some grandchildren. that's a big gift. So I'm joined today by my co-founder, Anne McCarthy. Please, Anne, and vice chair of the Cancer Supportive Care Society in Kamloops, and board members Star Webb and Janice McDonald. So thank you. That's my introduction, Peter.
Thank you very much. And Leslie, my apologies. I should have introduced you properly as the chair of the Kamloops Cancer Supportive Care Society. I'm rusty after 4 years.
We'll give you a little bit of
okay, thank you. That's my mulligan, isn't it?
Yeah, that's
all right. And I'm a lousy golfer. Heidi Coleman, CEO of Royal Inland Hospital Foundation. Heidi.
Thanks, Peter. So yes, I'm Heidi Coleman, and I'm the CEO of the Hospital Foundation. I came here 10 years ago this July from Montreal to head up the foundation and build partnerships. And this is a perfect example of that work. And when I got to Kamloops, I could see that I heard all the stories about cancer care, and I looked at our beautiful cancer treatment clinic up on the 8th floor. But what was lacking and continues is supportive care. I would get calls from donors and would ask me, can you connect me to this? And I knew that when they were in Kelowna, they had Inspire Health. I heard a lot about it. And of course, meeting Leslie and her team, we brainstormed how we could bring more supportive care to Kamloops. And through family friends, I knew Lavina, who is the CEO of Inspire Health, and that just leads us all here today. So it's really a very wonderful day for the citizens of Kamloops and all of our region that we can improve supportive care for cancer patients.
Thank you very much, Heidi. John Larmette, Executive Director of the BC Cancer Foundation, or BC Cancer in the Interior. And John, you're joining us online this morning.
Yes, thank you, Peter. Good morning, everyone. I am John Larmitt. I'm the Executive Director of Operations for both BC Cancer Kelowna and BC Cancer Prince George. You may see three of me on the screen in the event we have some questions through the audience. I did and have requested that I brought two guests with me here today. I would like to introduce Christy Hodgins. She is a registered dietitian at BC Cancer Kelowna, and Suzanne Thompson, who is a clinical social worker as well, acknowledging that I may not have all the answers to some questions that could get posed from the panel or from the audience. So again, just wanting to acknowledge that we have people here who know this information and work in this space and are much more better to answer the question than I. So very pleased to be with you here this morning. And again, looking forward to the event.
Thank you very much, John. And next is Dr. Hannah Nettie. She is the Director of Clinical Services at Inspire Health Supportive Cancer Care.
Thank you, Peter. Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Hannah Nettie, and I am a physician and the Director of Clinical Services at Inspire Health Supportive Cancer Care. I'm also a mother to two young children, a wife, and a sister to two cancer survivors. In the almost 20 years since my medical training, I have focused on several areas of medicine, including mental health, mind-body medicine, community health, and then for the last decade, supportive cancer care. My passion is being part of initiatives such as this to connect more people with the essential life-changing support that supportive care can provide. I wanted to say a big thank you to all of you for being here, to the Kamloops Cancer Supportive Care Society and the Royal Inland Hospital Foundation for inviting Inspire Health to be part of this event, this important initiative, and this conversation today, and to the community for joining us today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nettie. And the person, the lovely person just to the right of me, is Shiv Panu. I didn't mess it up too much, did I? All right. She is a breast cancer survivor, and she's also an Inspire Health patient. Shiv.
Thank you, Peter. Hello, everyone. A little bit nervous here, but I want to say ditto to what Leslie, Heidi, Hannah, and Peter have said. I have brought my smile here from Vancouver as well, and I got my diagnosis in 2016, right breast, and 5 years, like Chris, 5.5 years on now, and here to talk about Inspire Health, how it benefited me, tenfold, 100 miles away, whatever you want to say, and I want to spread the word like wildfire. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Shiv. You know, we're delighted to be, for you to be here, and we're delighted to be here as well with this great group of panelists and with all of our guests here at in the Delta Hotel in Kamloops, and of course online as well on Zoom. And who hasn't been Zoomed out yet after 2 years? I'm still fiddling with the buttons and stuff. But I have a 7-year-old grandson, so if I ever have problems, I just call him and he fixes, he reboots the whole server. You know, when we talk about Inspire Health Supportive Cancer Care, it really is a collaboration of many, many disciplines and many different organizations. And it's all for the good of the community and, of course, the patient who is indeed taking this journey. It's a multi-pronged initiative. And for our guests joining us online, please feel free to put your questions into the Q&A, which I don't know how to do, into the Q&A, you probably do. And if we have time, we'll try to answer some of those questions prior to the demonstrations. But let's head over to the panel right now. The first question I have here is, why the need for this event itself? And Leslie, we're going to go to you first.
Okay, so I'll just tell you a little bit about the Kamloops Cancer Supportive Care Society first, and then why this event is just so important. Our society came together about 2 years ago as a community group of people with shared lived cancer experiences. And we really were catapulted by the research that we found. Everybody was telling us the same things and the gaps that every single person was experiencing in supportive care. We're also motivated by the hopefulness of expanding services for the Kamloops area, cancer patients, improving outcomes, and our desire to help others. So just before I get into any more details, I just want to let you know our website is camcancersupport.ca, and we've developed it as a gateway for easier access to the services that are available. So national, provincial, and local research all tell the same story. The research tells us that 70% of cancer patients experience psychosocial distress, and 70% of cancer patients experience moderate to major pain during and post-treatment over prolonged time frames, and some even permanently. It's cancer, as we know, is a painful and life-altering experience. A great quote is from a doctor who reminds us that the medical treatment is only part of it. Cancer, it affects every part of your life, and that's where cancer supportive care is so important. Research also tells us that cancer supportive care improves outcomes for cancer patients, and it reduces the burden on the health society. So our society is been working collaboratively with RH Foundation, BC Cancer, and now Inspire Health to bring supportive care services to Kamloops and area patients. We've been advocating to BC Cancer Agency, and as I said, working with Inspire Health and the foundation. So why this event? We need to work together as a community and get Kamloops and area patients the help they need to realize better outcomes. This is critical. We need to get help to easier access to services and make them available as quickly as possible. Thank you.
And Heidi, the same question to you, and how the Rutland and Hospital Foundation's role, what role do you people play?
Well, first, the event, why the event? The event is to, even so Dr. Netty told me not to scream, but to scream it from the rooftops that we have more supportive care in Kamloops. So that's the reason for the event, because it was last December. I know with COVID it's a bit hard, but last December when I called Lavina, CEO of Inspire Health, and said, listen, can we get Inspire Health here in Kamloops? You have it in Kelowna, Vancouver, Victoria. And she said, absolutely. So it's actually started already online, but we are announcing it today so everybody knows that it exists, so that everybody can use the service. And I know a lot of people need a lot of supportive care, whether it's dietitians, mental health, physio, whatever it is, Inspire Health can help with. And why are we here at the foundation? Well, we are fundraisers and we are helping to support even financially this event today. But of course, we if there is some costs, then we want to be able to provide them for our patients, for our community. And so we're working with Inspire Health and Kamloops Supportive Care, but we're very committed to this. We have, as we know, during COVID, Kamloops patients and our surrounding area, with them, that cancer marched on, and that didn't stop. I also note that in the hospital, when we hear about operations being canceled, cancer operations were not canceled, and either were trauma. A lot of, we know, orthopedics, hips and knees got canceled, and a lot of those surgeons found it very difficult to pay their overhead, but the surgeons that deal with cancer were very busy. So then it's the aftermath, needing more supportive care, and that can be a social worker. It's a small community. We ski with the oncologists and the GP oncologists. We all know each other, and they do talk about how it would be great to have more supportive care for their patients. So we've pulled it all together, and we're just announcing it here for all of you and everyone online.
Thank you very much, Heidi Coleman. CEO of the Royal Inland Hospital Foundation. Yeah, you know, at the end, Heidi mentioned people are wondering what supportive care is. And that's my next question to the panel. What is cancer supportive care? What does it look like for cancer patients? Because we can throw terms out all we want, and some of them are rather elaborate. But if we don't dumb it down and actually have people understand what we're talking about, it doesn't really mean anything. And we'll go to the expert, John, online. That question to you. What is it?
Thank you, Peter. So supportive care, Leslie mentioned earlier, BC Cancer and our partners at Interior Health, not only is our focus on the actual treatment, so providing either systemic therapy, some people will refer or know that more broadly as chemotherapy, as well as radiation treatment, but it doesn't stop there. And so supportive care focuses on the prevention and management of any of the adverse effects that cancer and its treatment could result in. So the focus is on both physical and psychological effects that occur over the cancer continuum or experience, from a diagnosis through to treatment and into survivorship or end of life. We look and we know that cancer care is a team sport. It's multidisciplinary in nature. And not only are nurses and radiation therapists who focus on the treatment, we also have a large emphasis placed on things like social work, psychosocial care, nutrition support and management, speech language pathology, just to name a few. But really, supportive care is the term used for kind of all other services made available in a cancer system that are not specifically focused on the actual treatment itself.
Thank you very much. That's very informative. And Hannah, the same question to you, please.
Thank you. So as John mentioned, supportive cancer care is really focused on supporting the whole person during cancer, in the context of those important and, you know, foundational treatments that John was mentioning, like chemotherapy, radiation, surgery, immunotherapy. So supportive care looks at that support and that care that's needed during cancer, both from a dimension of physical health, emotional health, mental health. Things like reducing stress, boosting nutrition, managing side effects of treatment, and using exercise to help with your recovery. Another important aspect of supportive care is that it focuses on supporting the loved ones of people with cancer. So that's the families, the partners, the caregivers, and all of the community around the person with cancer. And we know how much of an important component that plays. Supportive care is going to look different depending on what stage of the cancer journey someone is currently traveling. It's all about looking at how these different elements of health can affect each other. So for example, we know that during treatment, if people are able to support their appetite, if people are able to keep moving with some exercise and get the rest and the sleep that they need, that then they're more likely to be able to complete their course of chemotherapy. And they're more likely to get the best outcomes that they can get through that cancer therapy. So all of these dots connect, and supportive care wraps around that cancer experience and provides that, that support throughout the treatment and beyond. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Doctor. You know, it seems to me there are so many potential benefits for supportive care for patients, as well as their outcomes, of course. And the people who are in their circle, their support structure, as well as even, I guess, on a bigger scale, the healthcare system. And that brings me to my next question here. What are the benefits? I mean, the real, you know, let's nail the nuts and bolts. What are the benefits of supportive care for cancer patients? And once again, John, we'll go to you with that question, first of all.
Thank you, Peter. Thinking of the healthcare system in its broadest context, what we know is the research tells us that supportive care improves the efficiency and effectiveness of the cancer system, and it's also actually extremely cost-effective. So Dr. Netty mentioned before, you know, if we have these services made available to patients whilst undergoing their cancer treatment, the supportive care enhancements of some of the disciplines that we mentioned earlier, they actually can go a long way to improving the outcomes of that patient's specific treatment, as well as reducing things like emergency room visits that could be intervened at a much earlier time. So in this instance, it actually has direct and indirect costs, cost reductions, pardon me, when we look and have supportive care services available than when we don't. And what we know is by improving that effectiveness and efficiency of having supportive care available, it actually improves the quality of life and improves patients' prognosis when they are diagnosed with cancer. And this is reduced even further by the development of patient care pathways where BC Cancer, working in partnership with Inspire Health and many other community organizations, make sure that we connect the dots that patient may be experiencing.
Thanks very much, John. And we haven't heard from Shiv, because really when it comes down to it, it affects the patients, the people who are actually going through the whole process of being diagnosed, being treated, and then looking for follow-up care. And Shiv, maybe you could answer that question on a personal level.
Yes, Peter, so true. When I got my diagnosis, I was just shocked. And I was living alone, and I thought, who's going to take care of me? I had my parents, but they don't have to look after me. I have to look after them. So I was at the surgeon's office, and the nurse gave me the pamphlet to Inspire Health, and the next day I was there. So I wanted to say that the anxiety of that I went getting my diagnosis was through the roof. But when I went to Inspire Health the next day, it came down a lot. And like Dr. Lamert was saying, that John Lamert was saying, that it really helps your emergency visits go down, because you learn how to cope. And with Inspire Health giving me all the tools, I have to say in their glory that they were there for me. And BC Cancer as well, there was so much there as well with the, they have their support as well. I spoke to Anne today, who is from Kamloops Cancer Care, and she said this quote by Bell Hooks: rarely, if ever, are any of us healed in isolation, and we cannot. We need Inspire Health supportive care.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Shiv. And Dr. Netty, the question to you from the perspective of a clinician.
Thank you. So this is a really important question. And I think that it's the heart of supportive care is, you know, why is this so valuable and so important? So I'm going to touch on three different areas. And the first one John mentioned, and that's about supporting quality of life. And when I mention quality of life, I'm really talking about that full spectrum, that, you know, that whole person. So I'm talking about things like building strength and improving mobility or maintaining mobility through treatment. So you can continue to take the walks that where you get your fresh air and you get those full breaths into your lungs. Helping with balance, so we can reduce falls and other things that can make things harder during cancer. Reducing nausea, improving appetite. We know that appetite is directly linked to our mood and our ability to get the energy that we need from our food. Reducing stress, improving sleep, and thereby really addressing one of the main symptoms that we hear from people, and that is fatigue and low energy. Helping with worries, fears, as Shiv mentioned, you know, a lot can come with a cancer diagnosis and a cancer journey and improving mood. So all of these elements are key pieces of improving that quality of life. And that's what supportive care looks at and speaks to. And this can be very individualized for the person because it's all about what's happening for that person. Another really important area about supportive care is that it focuses on that connection with one another really addresses the isolation that can often come along with a cancer diagnosis. People can feel very alone. They can have a lot of fear and not know who to talk to. So reducing that isolation is a really big piece. The other thing that we hear from people is that they're looking for support. They're looking for information as part of their support, and knowledge to make their best decisions and to feel that they are, you know, empowered with the information they need to navigate through their journey. So that's a big piece too, is connecting with that community of support and to get the information and knowledge that's needed for people. And all the research that several of my panelists, co-panelists have mentioned backs all of this up. So we have research looking at all of these different areas. We have research looking at all of these different ways that quality of life is supported. And more of this research is coming out, linking stress reduction, linking a nourishing diet, exercise, and that positive support network to better quality of life during cancer, improved recovery, and better cancer outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shanna. You know, so given all these benefits, especially in terms of this support, what it means to the patients and their families, what are some of the gaps that exist for cancer patients today? Because there are still some gaps. And that's probably one of the reasons some of you are here today, not only to learn what's available, but how to fill some of those gaps. And same with our online Zoom audience right now. Leslie, let's go over to you. What's needed for patients during cancer besides the treatment?
Thank you very much, Peter. So from my personal experience, when our son was diagnosed with cancer and we were in a room with a doctor and a social worker and a nurse, and you're shocked to the core, as you all know. And the question was, okay, so what do you need? And I thought to myself, I don't know. And I'm sure my son thought, I don't know. And we didn't know. And so this is another reason why this launch today and raising awareness is so important, because things that you just took for granted in your everyday life, you don't even know as the patient and as the family support what you need to be aware of and what you need to be ready for. So I just want to quickly go through some of those, and then I'll just highlight the gaps as I see them for Kamloops and our group sees them for Kamloops and area patients. So even understanding the medical treatment and your options. So you have your appointment with your doctor, but again, you're just in shock. You need time to absorb that. You need a time and a place to query, ask more questions. Emotional. As Dr. Hannah and Shiv said, and we keep talking about, is it's not just the medical, it's every other piece. So the emotional distress, coping, counseling, peer support, fear of recurrence, social ostracism. I don't know about you, but I know our family, people didn't know what to say. They didn't know how to talk to us. They didn't, that was huge. People would see you in the street and they would just freeze because they knew what was going on, but they didn't know how to interact with you. Support groups. The physical impacts and limitations, things like strength, physio, massage, acupuncture, fertility, nutrition, meditation. Financial impacts are huge. There's income loss, income replacement, financial management, tax implications, medication, travel and accommodation. You don't even know to ask these questions. Care options, home care, community care, palliative care, and end of life care. Like, who do you talk to about these things? How do you get the information that you need? Workplace challenges, losing your job, leaving your job, the job limitations, returning to work, and the ostracism in the workplace, because again, people just don't know how to interact given your experience. And legal, in our situation, and Shiv, you've probably had the same experience. My son is a single guy, Shiv's single. Who's going to represent you when you're too ill to represent yourself and talk? Who do you give that power to represent you and advocate on your behalf? Powers of attorneys, wills, do not resuscitate orders. As horrible as that sounds, you do have to consider those things with a serious diagnosis. And so who's going to look after that? And who tells you about that until it's presented? And then you have to make some decisions. And then, of course, your caregiver support. So all of those things, there's a myriad, and different patients have different needs, of course, depending on the degree of their disease, their culture, language, your physical condition at the time, your family support, your support network, and so on. But all of these things, I would say 90% of these things came into play in my son's situation.
Dr. Hannah or Dr. Nettie, Hannah, your perspective on all this.
Thank you. So when we think about what's needed for people experiencing cancer, I think oftentimes there can be quite a bit, you know, of a difference between what's needed depending on where they are in their journey. So when we see people who have just been diagnosed with cancer, there's often, as many have described, a lot of feelings of, you know, worry and overwhelm, and they can feel quite alone. And this time between diagnosis and treatment can be especially challenging. It can affect, you know, things that we've been mentioning, sleep and stress levels and relationships. And we see people having to deal with, you know, making a lot of decisions during this time, and they may not have that support system in place. So the support that's needed at that time is going to look different than if we, you know, take sort of the next stage of the journey for many people during treatment. And this can look different for everybody. You know, each person traveling through treatment is going to have their own unique experience. But for many people, it can turn to, you know, how do I manage side effects? How do I get the support that I need in my community and in my family? How do I manage feelings of isolation? I know something that's that we've heard a lot during COVID is, you know, that cancer is isolating, and then you layer on, you know, the worry that can come around immunity and health with COVID, and it's been an extra burden for people to navigate, an extra stress. So, you know, looking at what's needed during that cancer treatment stage, you know, a team of healthcare professionals who have an expertise in providing supportive care and who can link people to what's needed for them during that stage can be vital, can be essential for people. And then that stage after treatment, you know, for many people, they may still be looking at, you know, cancer treatments, maintenance therapies, but this stage can look different. It can present with, you know, new questions for people. Sometimes people, you know, at this stage realize that the toll that everything has taken for them, and that can present new challenges. So at this stage, there can be new needs that can present, and that can go on for some time. You know, survivorship can, you know, be a many, many year journey for many people. So really looking at individualizing that support to where people are at and what they need at that time. And then thinking about a really important aspect is the support people. So also looking at what's needed for support people, because we know if we're supporting, if we're able to support people to look after their own health during their journey, they're going to be better positioned and better able to support their loved ones. And then the last piece I'll just mention is that I think is really a key piece that's needed to address the gaps that we see in care is that collaboration piece. So this is a wonderful example of, you know, organizations and you know, community initiatives working together to really address what's needed in the community and you know, and for individuals in that community. So that collaboration piece is an important part as well.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Nettie. All right, let's get down to the brass tacks, the nuts and bolts of all of this. because I think most of you are here today online and in person to actually get the answer of what's actually available for patients in Kamloops and the region today. And John, we'll go to you with that question first of all. John.
Great. Thank you so much. Like we mentioned earlier here, BC Cancer hosts and has social workers or patient family counseling, registered dietitians and nutritionists. But we also have highly specialized subspecialty areas of practice in the supportive care disciplines. So BC Cancer has a psychiatry service for those who have issues with anxiety, difficulty sleeping, any changes in personality, or the fear that Leslie mentioned there of the treatment and illness and the stigma at times that that a cancer diagnosis may come with. We also have highly specialized pain and symptom management physicians. It's an interdisciplinary group that's made up of nursing staff and clinical pharmacists that really assist patients with complex pain management. And also, there is an element around advanced care planning that also Leslie mentioned earlier there, that time and place to make and get affairs in order or make the decision around, what will my goals of care look like in the event that my prognosis changes throughout my cancer treatment. One thing I would like to mention, and I did see it in the question and answer section there by the name of Linda, BC Cancer also acknowledges that there is a gap in patient navigation. And although we're not where we would like to be, we have started to introduce Indigenous patient navigation into our cancer system. This initiative, it had started off with three BC Cancer sites in the province having this role in place, Victoria, Prince George, and Kelowna. And we're hoping that this is the start and advancement of much more patient navigation in the future. So we're starting with Indigenous patient navigation, and our hope is that we start to build further navigation type positions and build them into the system. We have other provincial resources that, again, like Leslie mentioned, are available through referrals. We do have vocational rehab specialists and some other disciplines that are available in the Vancouver Cancer Center. And I would say that, to a degree, that is a gap as well. Some of those services are not physically available in the Kelowna Center. But I think, what's most important to me, and Dr. Netty mentioned this, is that collaboration is really important, right? To be able to provide complementary services based on patients' wishes. You mentioned, Shiv, that obviously the milieu and the environment of Inspire Health, it's different than being in an actual acute, I'll call it outpatient cancer treatment center, right? There's an element of patient experience that, we will do what we can to support patients. But, when it comes down to personal choice, I think that, we want to work to complement one another, right? So BC Cancer has the primary responsibility for the treatment aspect, and we have supportive care as well. And then we partner with Inspire Health and other community organizations to deliver some of those other services. So again, I mentioned earlier, it's a team sport. We can't do it on our own. And so we just very appreciative of the partnership and the opportunity here for myself anyways to speak to the members of the audience here today.
Excellent. Thank you, John. John from BC Cancer. And maybe Leslie and Heidi would like to tag team this one. We're talking about the actual community, the involvement in the community, and how the community is affected by these services that are available.
I'm delighted to say, we're talking about what it is and what the needs are, but the exciting part of today, of course, is to announce that the partnership between the foundation, our society, and Inspire Health to expand access to supportive care services for Kamloops and area patients. So we're delighted with that, picking up on their success already in Vancouver, Kelowna, and Victoria, that cancer patients in Kamloops will have access to these great services. So we're thrilled about that. as well as the services, of course, of BC Cancer Interior Health. And in Kamloops, of course, we have Kamloops Cancer Connections, which is a group of private professionals providing extensive services for cancer patients as well. So just to let you know that on our website, again, what we're trying to do is create a convenient access point for people so they can go to one place, because you've got to have a PhD in research sometimes to find the services that you need. And I don't have one. So we've put together what we're calling a gateway. And again, it's cancersupport.ca. And there you can push a button and it'll connect you to either the website or call to Inspire Health, to BC Cancer. You can call your doctor or your oncologist if you're lucky enough to have a doctor. You can also call 811. There are lots of times that we used 811 when we just needed an answer to a question. And then, of course, Kamloops Cancer Connections, and we'll be adding more. So this is a great day for Kamloops, and we're really looking forward to providing more services and assistance to cancer patients in our area. Heidi.
Thank you, Leslie. So I just want to say, of course, partnership is great, and that's why we're all here. And I really want to thank Leslie and her group for doing a lot of the work, a lot of the research, and not stopping to make sure that our Kamloops and surrounding area people get the care that we deserve and that we need here. And of course, connecting with Inspire Health has been a dream. Of course, we have a BC Cancer Health Cancer Clinic on the 8th floor. What John was talking about was a lot of great services that are available in Kelowna, but we need them, of course, closer to home. And that's why we're partnering with Inspire Health for the gaps that exist. So for at the beginning, a lot of it will be virtual, but we do, I'm not going to say we dream, because we'll have something here, a physical, a space. It would be great to have a place where we can have supportive care in Kamloops, whether it's manned by Inspire Health or it's a partnership like here. When we fundraise for cancer care at the hospital and we have this beautiful big new Phil and Jenny Gilardi Tower, we also fundraise for cancer care, because as a lot of you know, 80-85% of patients, cancer patients, do have an operation. When I speak to Dr. David Kramer, who's an ENT doctor and a friend of mine, he's either finding cancer, ruling out cancer, taking out the cancer biopsy. So we know that our surgeons are very busy. So we raise money for all the medical instruments that they need. Dr. Anise Barton just told me that she would like to have a new ultrasound for the OR because it's getting used a bit by some of the vascular doctors, and she wants it all to herself. So we're using some money that we got from the Ray Fawcett Breast Cancer Center, from the Fawcett family, and from general donations that we get from grateful patients who give us donations for cancer care. So we're also putting some money aside now for supportive care, because right now we say it is the free support for cancer patients, but it's virtual, which is great, but we would like something more physical here in Kamloops. So the foundation is working really hard to make sure that all the patients in the community get the access and the care that we need. And we'll eventually have radiation therapy here. It'll be a satellite building that'll have two machines. And then we'll have people coming from all over to Kamloops to get the radiation care. And then they'll need Inspire Health and BC Cancer supportive care as well. So yes, a great day, June 21st. It's beautiful that it's Indigenous Day as well, because as John said, they're starting with Indigenous patient navigators who we do know have hard time accessing care, but we need it for everyone. And stay tuned, because there's a lot more that's going to be coming.
All right. Thank you, Heidi. And Dr. Netty, do you want to chime in on this, please?
Certainly. Thank you. So we have learned so much during COVID. This presented us with an opportunity to really look at things differently. And at Inspire Health, we built a platform of virtual programming, comprehensive, engaging programming. And the incredible thing, several people have mentioned that, a lot of the support that they received was in connecting with others and in building that community. And we have seen that happen in our online services. And today, we are really pleased to say that every single Inspire Health service is available online. So this presents an opportunity for people to access these services today and to get the benefits and to get their needs met starting today. So the access to this is incredibly easy. We've made this our priority to make it a seamless and easy experience to access these services. Yesterday, we launched a new website, and we look forward to feedback, but our plan all along with this website was to have it be easily accessible for everybody to connect and get started. As a nonprofit, we offer our services free of charge, as has been mentioned, and no referral is required. So again, that's another way to make it easier. And the other thing to say I think we're going to experience as a group as we go on today with the demonstrations, our programming is incredibly comprehensive and engaging. And we run more than 15 classes every week to connect people with this supportive care in many domains. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Doctor. And so exactly what happens when a patient calls? Hannah, to go back to you for a moment, what's the process? What's the protocol?
Certainly. So I think I'll speak to sort of the Inspire Health Services portfolio, and I'm going to ask Shiv to speak to sort of that, when a patient picks up the phone, what happens? So first of all, Inspire Health has that the support that's available is coming from a really caring and compassionate team of people. So we have patient care coordinators, supportive care physicians, registered dietitians, counselors, and exercise therapists that make up the team. We all work together for the best support of patients and their loved ones. And we provide our group programming through this team of people. So as I said, this programming is comprehensive and is sort of in several different areas. So one of those areas is stress reduction and counseling. This would be things like meditation classes, art therapy workshops, because creativity can be another portal for recovery for people. Self-care workshops, like building resilience and healthy communication with loved ones. The Life Beyond program is a program that we created in collaboration with our colleagues to address some of the gaps that we saw in people who were transitioning after treatment. So it's called Life Beyond Cancer program, and it's a 4-week series for people to get that support during that transition time. We also have classes in the area of nutrition support. So every week we run workshops so people can learn more about things like balancing blood sugars and cancer protective nutrition, and cooking classes that are interactive and you can learn simple new recipes with ingredients that are already in your house. We promise nothing crazy, nothing that you have to go to 3 grocery stores to find. And yummy recipes. And these are interactive sessions that you can ask your questions and reduce the intimidation factor for getting started. We also have exercise and movement classes, many different types, strength and stretch, cardio classes, yoga, qigong, and all of these classes, people are supported to access in a way that's safe for them and appropriate for them. We also have cancer education workshops. We talk about things like sleep and cancer. We talk about things like breast cancer education and rehabilitation, lymphedema, pelvic floor, sexual health. So things that many people have questions about during cancer. We also provide one-on-one support. So that team that I described, all of those team can meet people individually and talk about what's important to them, what their needs are, what their priorities are, and really tailor that conversation for what's going on for that person at that time. We also have support for support people. Programs for support people. Support people can join many of our programs other than exercise. And we also run a monthly workshop just for support people to get that unique support for them. So I hope this has described all of those wraparound services to support people with cancer and their support people during this journey. Thank you.
Cooking classes.
Yes, wow. Indeed. Yeah.
You know, when my kids were still at home, and I did the cooking the odd time, we actually all prayed after we ate. And there was always a fire extinguisher and poison control on the speed dialer. But I just want to briefly go over to you, Shiv, because you were the patient. Yeah. You called. Okay. So what was the process?
Now I'm in cancer maintenance, and Inspire Health is there. Inspire Health will always be there. Was there from day one to now. And I do everything that Dr. Hanna was talking about, except the cooking classes, because now I know everything. And talking about the names that she was, about stores to go to, they even give you names to go and get that stuff. So it's not, you make everything easy. Everything is easy. And it is really easy. The minute you call, the voice is unassuming, caring. And so I started with yoga, meditation. When I was going through chemo, I did the acupuncture, which was free, 6 sessions. This was before COVID. And now with COVID, it's amazing how we can, everyone from anywhere around Canada can have access because of Zoom, because of this platform that we have. And what a way to start with that during this hard time. And I think it's benefited everybody. Even no one could make it to anywhere, but we could make it to our computers. So I think that's wonderful. So going back to classes, yoga, meditation, I still do. Tonight I'll be doing Qigong at Vancouver. Fly back and do Qigong. Lymphedema class about, we are not told much about the lymphatic system by the surgeon, or I'm not saying anything bad here, but I think the lymphatics plays a major role. And then talking to doctors and counselors, and they collaborate with BC Cancer with the counselors. If you're with BC Cancer, they take care of us there, and then vice versa. And even before COVID, I would be driven to Inspire Health by the Freemasons. So, I mean, it's just endless. It's just going to go farther and farther. The more we talk about it, the need for people to know about it.
Thank you very much. And before we get to the demonstrations, and Leslie, I'm just going to swing back over to you. You seem to have all the information when it comes to the websites. I know a lot of people have pen and paper in hand and at home as well. The website, because I think maybe some people missed, what's the easiest way to contact Inspire Health?
Well, to contact Inspire Health, the easiest way is to go straight to their website or phone them, and it's just inspirehealth.ca. Simple. However, if you're looking for a range of services and you forget the name of the organization, in Kamloops, our society has started a website that is a gateway. It'll take you to BC Cancer, Inspire Health, Kamloops Cancer Connections, 811. On one screen, it'll just tell you, you know, to sort of pick a portal and go. And it's camcancersupport.ca.
Excellent. Thank you. I want to thank the panel very much. Dr. Nettie, we've got some demonstrations we're going to show here online.
Yes, indeed. Thank you so much for that panel discussion. That was wonderful. So we're going to be joined soon by several colleagues at Inspire Health for some demonstrations. I'm delighted to be able to give you all a taste of our comprehensive and engaging programming. And there's even some participatory parts for those of you in the room here, if you'd like, or at home, we would welcome you to participate. And it's important to know that these are the programs that we're running every day and every week. And we reach hundreds of people every day through these online programs. And all of our group programs are online currently and going forward. So these programs that you're going to see now are a taste of what our community across British Columbia and beyond sees every day through our group programs. So the Qigong that Shiv mentioned that she'll be doing when she's back home in Vancouver, that's online tonight. So joining the community across BC. So just hoping that all of our colleagues are in the room here. We are going to start showcasing our demonstrations with Erin Roman, who is a registered dietitian and our program lead for our nutrition team. And I look forward to seeing what Erin is cooking up today. Thank you, Erin.
Thank you, Hannah. It's such a pleasure to be here this morning and just to hear the panelists speak this morning. So thank you everyone for being here. And we have a few minutes together this morning. It'll be the fastest cooking show ever. But as it's been mentioned a few times this morning, you know, nutrition can play a really important role in a cancer diagnosis and the journey. So whether you're awaiting treatment and you have a lot of questions that might be coming up, you know, we talked about a bit of that stress and fear. And sometimes that can come up in terms of our food choices and what our family and really well-meaning friends might be telling us that we should or should not be doing in terms of nutrition. Perhaps you're in the midst of treatment now and you have some questions about some side effects that you're experiencing, or you might be past your cancer diagnosis and wondering about making some shifts now. We're here to support you all along the way. So I thought I would make a really quick recipe this morning as an example of something that is kind of good all the time, but especially if we're experiencing some of the side effects like nausea. So we're going to make a really quick overnight oat recipe here that's got some really great supportive nutrients in it. So we're going to start out with 2/3 of a cup of oats. So I used quick oats last night because that's what I had on hand, but these are just some old fashioned rolled oats. So 2/3 of a cup of oats. We have 2/3 of a cup of whatever milk you choose to use. And that can bring up a lot of questions. So as Hannah mentioned, we do both one-on-one classes, one-on-one consultations, as well as our group classes. So if this does bring up questions for you, please do reach out to us. So we have a little bit of cardamom here, which can actually be a helpful spice when it comes to nausea. We tend to think about ginger. I'm putting 1/4 teaspoon in there. We tend to think about ginger as the one that can really help with nausea, but cardamom is another one that can add another flavor profile and also help with that feeling that we might be experiencing. Now I have some fresh ginger. This is what ginger root looks like. I have some fresh ginger, but you can also use powdered. So just use a pinch of ginger, of the ginger powder, if that's what you have at home, or I'm going to use about 1/2 teaspoon of grated ginger. Now I have this little tool here. You don't need any fancy tools. You could just use a box grater as well to get that a little bit of the grated ginger in there. Next, we have a little bit of lime. Now, for those that might be experiencing some mouth sores, you might want to stay away from the lime. But if you're not, then you should be fine. And usually, actually, the peel is okay. It's the lime juice that's the most acidic part of the citrus fruit. But I'm just going to use a little bit of the zest here just to add a little bit of a tropical flavor. Now, we mix this up. This will give us 2 servings, okay? This will last for about 3 or 4 days in the fridge. So if you wanted to double this recipe and make 4, so then you don't have to think about cooking in the morning and putting something together and something's already for you, then you can do that as well. I just brought out some little jars. I tend to use a lot of mason jars in my cooking. And we're basically just going to put this right in there. Last night when I just wanted to make 1 serving, I just halved the recipe and did it right inside the mason jar. Cut down on those dishes as well. Now, I love this recipe because it's another easy one that we could give to our family and friends if they're saying, hey, I'd really like to help. How can I support you? How can I make something to make your days a little bit easier? I know you're not feeling that great. This is a great one, okay? So we're just basically going to cover this and put it in the fridge overnight. These are just some lids that you can find. You can use a plain mason jar lid. I find these are handy because they're nice and reusable. You can find them at most grocery stores. I think I found those ones at Canadian Tire. Give it a little shake and then put it in the fridge. Now, once it's done, here's one that I made last night with the magic of television. It's a real cooking show. So it's quite thick, as you can see, okay? So it's really interesting when we soak oats versus actually cooking them and warming them up, we've recently found that it gives the bugs that are in our digestive system, that microbiome, which you've probably heard about, it gives them actually a really good source of food. So if this is too thick for your liking, just add a little bit more of whatever milk you're choosing to use, okay? So another nutrient that can be really supportive at this time, especially for healing, is protein. So with this breakfast alone, you're probably thinking, Erin, that's not that much food for my breakfast. I might need a little bit more. So let's add some things to this, super easy. So I'm gonna add a little bit of yogurt. Now yogurt comes in a wide range of consistencies and protein amounts. So take a look at the label, compare the ones that you usually have. I'm just using a plain yogurt because we're gonna add in a ton of flavor into this. So I've got just a plain yogurt, a locally made. This one's a bit runnier. It's a bit of a sign that it still has a good amount of protein in it, but some of these like Greek or skyr yogurts are super thick and a lot higher in protein. So just compare your labels. I'm gonna actually use a little bit of both in here. I'm just gonna top that with some yogurt. And then let's add some fun to this. I'm going to add a little bit of mango on top of mine to get some of those nice antioxidants from our fresh fruits and vegetables. I'm going to also add in some seeds. So I've got some pumpkin seeds, some sunflower seeds here as well. So I really like the crunch that that provides. Other things that you might want to think about, some toasted coconut I have here for flavor, and also, you know, just to make that satisfying type of breakfast. Hemp hearts that can give us fiber, protein, and some of those omega-3 fats. I've got granola, some nut butter, if you'd like to add some extra protein, extra fats, especially if you're looking for extra calories. So if you're needing to gain some weight, because that's one of the experiences that we might be having, adding some nut butter, you could use some coconut milk as your main source of fluid in it as well to boost it up. Just gonna top mine with a couple of pieces of banana and some raspberries. And there we have a super easy, fun breakfast. We can have this all ready to go in our pantry and in our fridge, nice and full of nutrition. It'll really give you a nice boost of hopefully energy to last you throughout the morning. And hopefully it'll also help with some of the nausea. And thank you. Thanks for the opportunity today to present. We do, like Hannah said, Dr. Netty said, we have lots of group presentations as well as individual one-on-ones. And we'd be happy to support you wherever you are at the moment.
Thank you so much, Erin. That was wonderful and yummy. I can taste it. So now we're going to go to be joined by my colleague, Gemma Templeton, who's a clinical counselor at Inspire Health and she is trained in mindfulness meditation as well. So Gemma is going to lead us through a meditation, and I invite you to participate if you would like. If not, you can sit and breathe and you'll still get lots of benefits from that. So we're going to dim the lights and thank you, Gemma, for taking us away.
Thank you, Dr. Netty, and thank you to my colleague Erin for the yummy display of delicious food. Being Scottish, of course, I'm all over the oatmeal, so thank you for that demonstration. All right, I would love to introduce us this morning to mindfulness meditation, which is known for its capacity to decrease our stress, also known to lift our mood, really good for our sleep, and also gives a really good boost to our immune system. So many, many capacities for it to give lots of advantages. The beauty of meditation is that you don't actually need a lot of time. You can actually do it in a few moments. The beauty of it also is that it settles the mind and the body pretty quickly once you settle in through this mindfulness breath and also giving awareness to the body. Because of the benefits of mindfulness meditation, at Inspire Health, we offer 3 classes of guided meditation at different times throughout the week as an opportunity for you to get started with this kind of support that's available to everyone who's here. It's available to all of you. So today I would like to invite us for a mini meditation practice. I did say we can do it in a few minutes, so I'm going to make that happen today. It's an opportunity for us to settle the mind and the body. And to practice this morning, we're going to do what's called a body scan. And so I would like us to do this together. I will guide us through a few moments of a body scan. This is an invitation to get comfortable in whatever position is best for you right now. You can have your eyes open or your eyes closed. Opportunity also to drop your eyelids with a soft gaze, or perhaps find an object around the space you're in right now to focus on, using this as an anchor. We will bring our attention to different body parts this morning and just noticing that you may notice different feelings, you may notice different sensations that arise, and that's all good. That's natural process. At any point, if you feel that the area we're focusing on is not okay for you today, then instead, take your focus to another body part that's accessible for you, just knowing that this is a lovely invitation. Let's start with a breath in for the whole body, everyone. So let's take a nice, big, deep breath in. Breath in, everyone. And a nice breath out. Allowing yourself this morning to be exactly as you are, using your breath as an anchor. No need to change the breath. The breath will change on its own. We are simply bearing witness this morning to any sensations throughout the body scan. Let's start with noticing our feet. Let's bring attention to our feet. And if there are any areas in the body that are not accessible for you to focus on today, then bring your attention to another body part that feels okay. So let's notice our feet, bearing witness to the feet, to the toes, soles of the feet and the front of the feet, the ankles and the heels. Locating your breath, either noticing the breath through the belly, rise and fall of the belly, perhaps the breath through the rise and fall of the chest, or the breath through the nostrils. Those are three ways we can locate the breath. Oftentimes holding our breath shallow or forgetting to breathe. So locating the breath is a good thing to remember to do, just to remind yourself. Just to ask, where's my breath right now? Softening the shoulders, relaxing the hands, and loosening the jaw. Bringing your attention to the feet. And just noticing what's there. Breath for the feet. Allowing the body to soften. If the mind wanders as it will, focus on the breath. An opportunity to focus on the breath gives that busy mind a little respite, a bit of a break. Bringing your attention to the legs if that's available to you today. Noticing the legs. Awareness of all sensations. Locating your breath. Simply settling in. Remembering to breathe. Finding the rhythm of your own breath. No need to change anything. There's no wrong way to meditate. No wrong way to find the breath. Bearing witness to the legs. allowing the body to settle, allowing the mind to come home through the breath. Invitation to come home to the breath. Taking our attention now to the front body. Noticing the belly and the abdomen. Awareness of the middle of the body and the rib cage. And whatever organs are housed in the body. A chance to notice the rise and fall of the chest, perhaps. Your heart center. Allowing the body to settle. Bringing your breath back. Just bearing witness, simply noticing. No expectation, no agenda. A breath into the lower back, often a place we hold tension. Using the breath as an anchor. An opportunity to release any tension through the breath. Letting the shoulders melt from the ears, relaxing your hands, softening the jaw, sinking into your space, noticing the mid-back, if the mind wanders as it will, with gentle compassion, if that's available this morning, simply bring it back. Taking our attention to the shoulders. Releasing any tension there in the shoulder blades and the middle of the shoulder blades. Softening the shoulders. Just noticing. Tuning into what's here right now. Right here and right now. Awareness of your upper arms. From the upper arm to the elbows. From the elbows to the wrists. Awareness of all sensations. Putting out the welcome mat, simply noticing. A breath into the hands, the front of the hands and the back of the hands. To the fingertips, to the fingernails. Awareness of a softening. Locating your breath. A breath into any tension we hold in the neck area. Simply bearing witness with no expectation this morning, no agenda. Simply a chance to settle the body, settle the mind. Giving some respite for a few seconds even. Can feel like a 20-minute nap to have a few seconds in mindful meditation. Lovely replenishment, recharging, and noticing the face and the head. A breath in to relax the jaw and the teeth. Often we clench or grind, as I catch myself doing quite often. Reminding myself to soften the jaw. Noticing the breath through the nostrils. You may hear some sound or feel any sensation, the air coming through. Breathing into this breath of life this morning, coming home to the breath. Noticing the eyes, the eye sockets and eyeballs, and the forehead. Not forgetting the crown of our head, our brain. And our ears. Allowing this breath to come to the face and the back of the head, to the sides of the ears. All the way down the front body to the ankles, to the back body, to the back of the heels and down the sides of the body, insides and the outsides, coming back to the feet. Sitting here for a few seconds with the breath, bringing the mind back if it wanders, simply anchoring yourself through the breath, through the feet, softening the body, noticing the ankles and heels, soles of the feet and the front of the feet, the toes. A nice breath in, everyone. Nice big breath in. Let's rest for a moment in awareness, knowing that I will guide us back together in a few seconds. Settling into that delicious breath for a few seconds more, knowing that this opportunity is available for you at any given time. For a few seconds, whether you're laying down or standing or sitting, just ask yourself, where is my breath right now? Locate your breath and anchor through the breath. When you feel ready, if you're comfortable, to notice your hands, you can squeeze the hands if that's comfortable. Saying hello to the toes and noticing the toes and the feet. If you are comfortable and are able, a little gentle stretch, a gentle shake to come back together, an offering invitation to soften your gaze, get ready to come back together, allowing the light to come to you as you slowly and gradually come back together to open your eyes gently. And if you wish, take a nice last breath in. Releasing and letting that go. Saying thank you for joining me this morning. Glad I could be part of this event today.
Thank you so much, Gemma. I think we all feel more relaxed and restored from that. Thank you so much. Okay, so we're going to take a few minutes to move together. We're going to do about a 5-minute moment with Steph Galitzin, who's one of our wonderful exercise therapists. Thank you, Steph.
Thank you, Hannah. Hi, everyone. Super, super wonderful to be here with you all today. I'm going to give you a little taster of one of our most popular classes. And this is a class that I have seen Shiv in for the past 2 years very consistently that I've been with Inspire Health. And it's our group strength and stretch class. So I'm just going to give you a little taste with an example of one of the circuits that we do in the class. And I also actually just finished teaching this class right before this webinar today to over 100 people around our province. And just to speak quickly to what Dr. Hananati spoke to earlier around individualization. So we know that those are quite large groups, and that makes it super fun and very accessible to people beyond our city centers. But know that also individualization is really important to us through our exercise services, because we recognize that those are 100 different humans, different bodies with all very unique experiences. So we do have one-on-one appointments before people join full classes to make sure that they are appropriate and safe, and that they're choosing the right options and modifications qualifications. So just know that that is what we offer through exercise services, and I hope to see many of you in those one-on-ones and classes soon. So today I'm going to demonstrate the movements first with lots of options, so just watch. But then if you'd like, I would love to have you join me in a short amount of movement today. So like I said, I'm going to demonstrate first, and I will give seated and standing options. We're going to do one strength exercise, one balance exercise, and one cardio exercise today. So again, just watching me to begin with, I'll let you know when we will start moving together. For our strength exercise, it's going to be a lower body strengthener. So as a seated option, we have a sit to stand. So those of you at home, or if you are in Kamloops today and you're seated, you can have your feet right under your knees. We'll raise our arms up to our shoulders, leaning our weight into our legs to begin with, and then pressing through our heels to stand our body all the way up, and then sitting our hips back and down to come back to our seat. And you'll repeat this movement. Another option is to stay seated and do a seated knee extension. You can hold onto your chair for additional support, bringing one leg up at a time, staying nice and tall. If you want to do a standing option, you can do a standing squat in the air, moving down to whatever depth feels good for you. So it can be quite small, or you can make it a larger movement if you'd like. The second exercise that we're going to do is balance. Here, holding on to perhaps a chair or a wall if you'd like some support and you have that space, we're going to rise up to our toes into our calf raise, and then we're going to rock back onto our heels, lifting our toes into the air and just rocking back and forth. So this will challenge our balance. You choose how wide or narrow you'd like your feet to be. If you would prefer to stay seated today, you can do this exact same movement from a seated position. The last movement we're gonna do is a cardio movement, either a march or a jog. Your seated option, moving arms and legs from your seat. If you would like to stand, you can march. This is my low impact option, or high impact option can be a jog on the spot. If you have any hip, knee, ankle pain or discomfort, or any spinal concerns, I do recommend that you take the low impact standing or the seated option, okay? So I'm gonna play a little bit of music as we do in our classes to make it fun for us. And a reminder that you can join if you'd like, you can watch if you'd like, choose whatever option is gonna feel best for you in your body today. We're gonna do 30 seconds per exercise, and you move at whatever pace feels good for you. All right, so if you wanna sit, you can stay seated. If you wanna stand, you can stand up. I'm gonna play us a tune. This is one of the songs that was requested by a patient a couple weeks ago. So here we go. We're gonna start with our lower body strength. So you can sit, you can stand. I'm gonna do the sit to stand, but if you wanna do the seated knee extension or the air squat, go for it. All right, in 3, 2, and 1. Whenever you're ready, you can start moving. So either doing your air squat, your sit to stand, or your seated knee extension. Again, moving at whatever pace feels good for you. Press down through your heels if you're standing up. You have 10 seconds to go. Maybe getting a couple more in. And 3, 2, and 1. Okay, next up is our balance exercise. So you can stand, or if you want to sit and do the foot rock, you're welcome to do that. Everyone ready? In 3, 2, 1. So up to your toes, and then rock back onto your heels. So again, gonna feel a little bit unsteady here. A little bit of a challenge is a good thing. And you can return to sitting at any point if you're standing. We got 10 seconds to go. And 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, our last exercise is our cardio exercise, marching, seated, standing, or jogging. We're gonna do it all together for 30 seconds in 3, 2, and 1. So a reminder, at whatever pace feels good for you. So you might match me, you might not, we're all different. Moving arms and legs, you're about halfway. Oh Shiv, I can see you in the back there. You have about 15 seconds left to go. Almost through it together. And 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, shake it out. We also do high fives lots of the time, even in this virtual world. So high-fiving to your camera, or if you are in person, around up to the front. That is our movement together today. Thank you for moving with me. I'll pass it back over, but I hope to see you again soon. And thank you everyone for being here today.
Thank you so much, Deb. That was perfect and got us moving. Thank you. Wonderful. Well, thanks for to our team for those demonstrations and for all of you for being here for that. And I'll pass it back to you, Peter. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I want to thank the instructors and, of course, our panelists today. It was great. And my biggest thank goes to those folks listening online or watching online. And for you in the room today, I hope it was informative, educational, and certainly helpful on so many levels. I want to remind everyone, you can get the need you help once again at inspirehealth.ca. You'll see that up on the screen in a moment here. And as well, there's a phone number. Have we got the phone number up on screen here? Yes, we do. Feel free to contact them. I know many of you either are going through this journey yourself, or you have family members or friends, people close to you, possibly even co-workers going through it. And once again, on behalf of the panel, Inspire Health, and the Delta Hotel, and everyone who hosted us, and the organizers, thank you again, and have a good afternoon. Thank you again.